Hello everyone, and welcome to another Raya Holloway Geography for School lecture. The topic today is the Earth climate system, and I'm going to talk about how atmospheric and ocean circulation transport heat around the world. I'm Dr Celia Martin Puertas, a lecturer in physical geography, and I specialize in reconstructing the climate of the past to help understand future potential responses of the Earth climate system to global warming. I want to introduce my PhD student, Mrs. Laura Bouillon, who has designed and created the in-class activity for you. This is a story map that will help you to find out more about ocean circulation. Hope you like it and enjoy learning about the ocean. Well, let's start talking about what climate and the Earth climate system are. Climate is the average weather conditions like temperature and precipitation in a given region for a period of 30 years or longer. This is very important to distinguish between weather and climate. I think everyone is familiar with weather forecast and know that weather can change from one day to the next. Weather can actually be very variable between years and even decades in the same region, but climate keeps being stable. For example, this is a very big mistake when people or the media talk about climate change, saying something like, climate change is evident because this summer was the warmest summer in the last 20 years. Well, this is not quite right, and this is not climate change, but an extreme heat wave. We can only say that the climate is getting warmer if the average temperature in the last 30 years was higher than the previous 30-year slot. And unfortunately, this is exactly what is happening since the Industrial Revolution. In this graph, the blue and the red lines represent annual average global temperature, so weather variability. And the black line is 50 years global temperature average, representing climate variability. As you can see, from 1900 approx, the temperature shows an increasing trend, the famous climate hockey stick. This shows that global warming is happening, and that's true that in this warmer world, extreme weather events like heat wave, floods, or hurricanes happen very often. But how the Earth climate system works? The Earth climate system is an energy system which is driven by the sun. So the sun is the main source of energy, the engine of the climate. We can define the Earth climate system as the energy balance between the incoming solar radiation that is absorbed by our planet and the amount of this energy that is sending back to space. The different elements of the Earth system are the atmosphere, the ocean, forest, land, and ice, and are responsible for absorbing and reflecting this energy and transforming it into climate. So they receive the energy from the sun and makes the magic to make climate. The first element in contact with solar radiation is the atmosphere. When the energy from the sun gets the atmosphere, sun is absorbed and sun is reflected, mainly from clouds. The energy absorbed heats the Earth's surface, but some of this heat is reflected again. In this way back to space, another fraction of this energy is absorbed by greenhouse gases, reheating the Earth's surface. This is why the increase of greenhouse gases emissions results in an overheating of the Earth's surface and causing global warming. The way energy from the sun moves in and out the atmosphere and the way heats move around the globe results in different climates around the planet. And we are going to see these processes in detail now. First thing we need to know is that the sun's energy is distributed unevenly across the globe. And because the Earth tilts, the equator receives more heat than the poles. In addition, ice caps in the Arctic and the Antarctica reflects most of the energy because of the white color of the ice, so making the poles even cooler. According to that, we couldn't live in the tropics because they would be too hot, or in high latitude because they would be too cold. But this is not like how our planet is, right? So what's happened next? Well, as everything in nature and physics, the system needs to get an equilibrium, and the atmosphere and the oceans are responsible to move heat from the equator, where there is a surplus, to the polar regions to keep a balance, which makes our planet a nice place to live and rich in biodiversity. Good. I'm going to explain first the role of the atmosphere. The atmosphere has five layers, which are very different in composition, which means that they have different physical and chemical properties and different roles in the climate system. The layers in contact with the Earth's surface is called the troposphere, and here is where the weather and the climate happen. The distribution of the heat from the equator to the poles in the atmosphere is a chain of air convection cells. So from the equator to the polar region, the heat moves through the air in three cells. The Hadley cells of the tropics, ferrous cells at mid-latitudes, and polar cells in the polar region in both the northern and the southern hemisphere. A convection cell works like a room with a hot radiator and an open window. Imagine we are in the Hadley cell. The radiator is the equator, and the heat makes the air at the Earth's surface lighter, and it goes up to the upper part of the troposphere. When this air gets to the top, it moves in the only possible direction to the poles. So at 30 degrees of latitude, the temperature is getting cooler because this part of the planet doesn't receive as much solar radiation as the equator. This could be our open window bringing cool air into the room. So as the air is getting cooler, it is heavier and goes down again to the surface, returning to the equator to get warmer again. This is the same circulation models in the polar region, so in these polar cells. But our start point is the open window instead of the hot radiator. The surface air travels from the poles to lower latitude to get warmer, and then rises into the troposphere, where it travels again to the pole, where it's getting cooler, and goes down to the surface again. Between the Hadley cells and the polar cells are the ferrous cells. Air circulation here is not driven by temperature gradient, but flows in the opposite direction to the other cells, acting like a gear. So air circulation in the Hadley and polar cells are anti-clockwise, while the ferrous cells are clockwise. This clockwise and anti-clockwise air circulation, together with the own rotations of the Earth, drive the direction of prevailing winds at different latitudes at the surface. So this mechanism explains why there are trade winds in the tropics. So trade winds means winds from east to west, and westerlies, so winds from west to east at mid latitude. So trade winds in the tropics, westerlies at mid latitude. But the convection cells are also controlling where it's raining more and where it's drier, giving us our climatic zones. Where air is rising, an area of low pressure is created and more precipitation happens there. So this happens because the air ascendant has a lot of water that take from the Earth's surface, seawater, lakes, river, etc. When the air gets cooler in the upper part of the troposphere, the water condensates and forms clouds, hence rainfall. In this image, you can see the eye of a cyclone from the space, indicating the location of a low pressure center. Low pressure centers have more or less a fixed position around the wall, and they are in the equator, where the two halicels converge, and air rises from surface to the top of the troposphere, and at the border between ferrous and polar cells. So this is approximately 60 degrees of latitude in the northern and the southern hemisphere. So as you can see, the UK is in this band of latitude. So you can understand now why it's raining most of the time here. On the other hand, when air is descending, high pressure centers form, giving clear sky and little rainfall. In this situation, the descending air leaves an open eye free of clouds, as you can see in the satellite image, and no clouds, no rain. High pressure centers are located at the border between the Hadley and the Ferrocells at 20-40 degrees of latitude and in the polar regions. The combination of temperature and precipitation around the globe creates different types of biomes and landscape. Rainforest in the tropics, hot desert at subtropical regions, forest at mid-latitudes, and cold desert or tundra in the polar regions. But this is not everything we need to know to explain climate. The ocean has also a very important role on climate because it's the main responsible of heat distribution around the world. Most of the solar radiation is absorbed by the ocean, and 90% of this heat is kept in the first 100 meters. This is a very thin layer, given that the ocean is 500 times deeper. So in terms of heat transport, the ocean is very important because it has the ability to keep the heat for a very long period, so hundreds of years, and feeds heat to the atmosphere at the poles, contributing to atmospheric circulation. And also the carbon cycle is included in all these processes. So we used to say that the atmosphere has no memory because the exchange of energy happens very quickly. However, it takes much longer in the ocean. So both the ocean and the atmosphere control the Earth climate, but they act at different time scales. A priori, the ocean distributes the heat around the globe in a very simple way in comparison to the atmosphere. So there are only two large jars, one in each hemisphere, that move surface water from the equator to the polar region and back to the equator. Of course, controlled by this temperature gradient between the equator and the polar region, so the surplus and deficits. The continents, however, divide this larger in different ocean basins, and the water cannot go through them. So the prevailing winds at different latitudes also change the direction of these gyres, creating regional subgyres at the surface. The sum of all of this results in different ocean currents around the planet, such as the North Atlantic, the Labrador Current, South Pacific, the Atlantic Currents, etc. These surface currents are very important, and they are connecting to each other, and they transport the heat from the equator to the polar region and are very important for weather forecasting. However, if we want to talk about climate variability, remember that this is changes in the average weather conditions over several decades, we need to pay attention to the heat exchange between surface water and deep waters. If we make a vertical profile of the ocean, as you can see in this picture, from the Arctic to the Antarctica, we can identify different water masses at different depths. which are characterized by a given temperature and salinity. Salinity is the density of the water and measure the amount of salt in a specific water mass. Because these masses have different physical and chemical characteristics, they don't mix and flow around the planet at different depth and speed. Salty and cooler water travels at the ocean bottom and they are slower, while warmer and fresher water are at the surface. However, at some specific locations of our planet, surface waters sink to the ocean bottom, and this is called deep water formation, and bottom waters rise to the surface, which is known as upwellings. In this map here, you can see the location of the main spot of deep water formation and upwellings. So the deep water formations are indicated as a light blue circle in the northern hemisphere and a white circle in the southern hemisphere, and upwellings are the orange circle with a dot inside. So as you can see, deep water formation happens in the polar regions, in particular in the Labrador Sea and the east of Greenland, and in some part of the Antarctica as well, so West Antarctica. In these regions, the air temperature are cooler and the salinity of the surface water are relatively high, which makes the water to sink to the bottom because it's heavier. The upwellings, however, happens in very windy regions where winds move surface water, leaving an empty space that is replaced by deep waters. Upwellings happens in East Antarctica, but the main upwellings area is the subtropical, is the subtropics, sorry. Upwellings are very important for fishing because deep water are rich in nutrients, which makes the algae grow, and these algae are the food for fishes. So these regions are very rich in marine biodiversity and have many fishes to catch. The exchange of heat between surface water and deep waters in the ocean around the globe create this global ocean convergent belt of heat called the thermaline circulation. The circulation is called like that because it's driven by both the temperature and the salinity gradients happening in the oceans around the planet. Just as a fact, if we have a water particle, if we can track a water particle part of this thermaline circulation, it's going to take 2,000 years to go around the planet. This is why thermaline circulation is responsible for climate changes in the past and can explain, for example, the transitions between glacial condition and interglacial conditions in the last 2.5 million of years, so the current quaternary period. In the next slide, I'm going to show you a video of the thermaline, explaining the thermaline circulation and how changes in this due to global warming can trigger a rapid climate change similar to one happening 12,000 years ago called the Younger Dryas.
The oceans play a big role in controlling global climate by distributing heat around the planet. An important region for this is the North Atlantic Ocean. Ocean currents from the tropics bring warm, salty water northwards into the Arctic. Here, the warm water cools down and sinks in the deep ocean. As global temperatures increase, Arctic ice melts, increasing the freshwater input to the ocean. This lowers the overall density of the Arctic surface ocean waters, which may slow down or even stop deep water formation. This would have an impact on the ocean circulation patterns, heat distribution, and ultimately, our global climate.
Well, that's all from me today. Hope you enjoyed the talk and thank you very much for listening.